on you, Romania! Shame 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 on you, Romania!
Although the Bible makes relatively few references to hell, its graphic nature is forever emblazoned in several passages.
They will throw them into the fiery furnace, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Matthew chapter 13, verse 42. Depart from me, ye cursed, into the everlasting fire, prepared for the devil and his angels. Matthew chapter 25, verse 41.
The Bible's first clear reference to a hell of punishment comes in the book of Daniel.
Multitudes who sleep in the dust of the earth will awake, some to everlasting life, others to shame and everlasting contempt. Daniel chapter 12, verse 2.
Biblical descriptions of hell's agony culminate in a brief notation in the book of Revelation, the apocalyptic story about the end of the world and final judgment.
And the devil who deceived them was thrown into the lake of burning sulfur, where the beast and the false prophet had been thrown. They will be tormented day and night, forever and ever. Revelation chapter 20, verse 10.
David, this is God, again, speaking to you, from the holy heaven. There are two types of people in this world. Good people, and bad people. Good people do good things, and after they die, they come to live with me, in heaven. Bad people do evil things, and after they die, they go to live with Satan, in hell. Furthermore, there are two types of good people, and two types of bad people. The first type of good people are those who only do good things. The second type of good people are those who would do everything to stop the evil people from doing evil things. The first type of bad people are the so-called evil people. Those people have no heart, conscience, morals, or values. All Romanian politicians, judges, doctors, educators, and bureaucrats belong to that evil group. The second type of bad people are those who see the evil people doing evil things, yet they don't do anything to stop them. In my holy book of righteousness, the people who passively accept evil are as guilty as those who do the evil themselves. Those who chose to be neutral in situations of evil injustice have automatically chosen the side of the evil oppressors. Those who accept evil without protesting against it are guilty of cooperating with evil. The main majority of Romanians fall into this last category. They accept the evil, and instead of doing something to stop it, they blame the system. They are too ignorant to realize that if they will stop the evils from doing evil things, they will automatically change the system, change their lives, their communities, their country, and the world. They are not even aware of how bad, ignorant, coward, and inhumane they really are. the Romanian people, half truly fallen, below the level of beasts. Look now, at a small part, of what the civilized world saw in Romania, throughout the past 25 years, and then, be the judge, of what you see.
Tonight, new horrors in Romania. A disaster still unfolding. A two-part expose. Shame of a nation. Those stories tonight, October 5th, 1990.
Tonight, 2020 begins with a dilemma. A story that's so shocking that we know those of you at home are going to be disturbed by what you see. But a story that's so important that we just couldn't look the other way. Earlier this year, we reported on the plight of orphan children in Romania, which caused 25,000 of you to write to us. Now a new discovery. Thousands of Romanian children, many near death, others naked and starving, are being held in hidden asylums that resemble Nazi concentration camps. Most of what we will show you has never been seen before on American television.
This crisis is unfolding as we speak, but public exposure can force change. Just last weekend, 71 world leaders met at the United Nations to commit their countries to the long-term goal of improving the quality of life for children. But the situation in Romania demands immediate action. Tom Gerald journeyed to Romania, where people, and particularly children, are still suffering from the totalitarian policies of the Ceausescu regime. Here now, in a two-part investigation, is what Tom found.
In more than 50 institutions hidden in remote areas of Romania, innocent children are locked away like condemned prisoners. These are not the orphanages seen before on American television. These are state-run asylums, shrouded in secrecy. This is where children with physical or mental defects are banished by a government which has branded them worthless. Conditions are so shameful, the gates are padlocked. Outsiders rarely get in. This is why.
Your immediate feeling about this is an extermination camp. This is a place that's designed to get rid of these children, and it's being done in the most inhumane and undignified way possible.
Children here are filthy and unattended. They lie in their own waste, covered with flies, crippled by years of disease and confinement. They cower beneath cribs like cornered animals.
The eventual toll of living in such unsanitary conditions is obvious. In every institution we visited, we found critically ill children, some with perhaps only weeks left to live. And the attitude of the authorities, it's the system. There's nothing we can do about it.
The system is governed by laws. Laws are made by politicians. Politicians are chosen by people. Ignorant, brainwashed, manipulated and intimidated people will continue to elect evil and heartless politicians who, in turn, will continue to form evil and poisonous governments. Evil governments will continue to do evil, will destroy their people and their nation. Do not forget. The fish rots from the head, and that's exactly where the Romanians' problems, with their stinky smell, originated. All major problems in Romania can be traced back to its leadership. Corruption, poison, and evil entered Romania through its leaders. It filtered down to its citizens, and it destroyed the nation.
The Romanian government admits more than 8,000 children live in these state-run asylums. But Western sources say the figure is closer to 40,000. Among them, hundreds of perfectly normal children swept up by this heartless bureaucracy. This is the only life most will ever know. There is no way out.
It's a system not unlike Hitler's Auschwitz, a form of state-imposed genocide by neglect. At age three, the children in Romania's orphanages are sorted into two categories. The productive ones, healthy and normal, are sent to be educated in state-run orphanages.
The orphanages are far from perfect. But the children here are fed and clothed. The government is now raising 65,000 orphans as wards of the state. These are the lucky ones.
The rest are rejected and sent to medieval institutions like this one. Warehouses for what's called the deficient and unsalvageable.
The nurse says both these children are going to die.
These children are certainly doomed in terms of this kind of care.
Pediatrician Barbara Bascom was so overwhelmed by the misery she found here, she sold her home in Maryland and is devoting the next 3 years to what she calls a man-made disaster.
These children are dying every day, and it is a disaster. And the magnitude of this kind of a disaster, we haven't seen during our lifetime.
David, that was the reason, in 1993, your father returned to Romania, where he gave his time, money, and over 12 years of his life. He went there to help. He went there and did everything he could to help bring change.
Another American, Jan Berendei, has set aside his career as a Boston architect. Passionate in his zeal to help the country he escaped 20 years ago for freedom. After last December's revolution, Jan returned to Romania, obsessed with saving the children his homeland has written off as hopeless.
She doesn't know why she's here. She says that her mother left and maybe she will come back, but she doesn't know.
In a quest for outside help, Jan used a home video camera to document the conditions he found inside the institutions. At one facility, he witnessed a brutal show of inhumanity at bath time.
What was it like that day for the children?
It was horrifying for them because they were actually being bitten into coming into these rooms. The children were shrieking. They were in fact being herded into the bathroom.
The abuses captured by the lens of a home video camera seem to confirm the eyewitness reports we were hearing from international relief workers. 2020 set out to investigate. We traveled to Romania, crisscrossing the country, covering more than 1,500 miles in 6 days, to find out how many children are trapped in this nightmare. Jan agreed to act as a translator and consultant for 2020. Our first priority was Tuican Moran, the facility where Jan had seen the children terrorized by a nurse. We landed in an open field and headed for the institution with donated relief supplies. It had been 2 months since Jan had been here. It was quickly apparent not much had changed.
We can still see stationary water, the same black water that I saw 2 months ago. It may not even have changed since then.
Were they all washed in the same tub of water?
They were all washed in the same tub of water, and they were being pushed by two and three into this black-looking water, after which they were coming out as dirty as they came in.
The new director here was alerted of our arrival.
Does he see anything wrong with, and is the practice continuing, of taking youngsters into the shower area and putting them into a cold bath as if they're being herded like animals?
He says, in medical pathology, it's a well-known fact that people working in places like this, they become like animals themselves.
The director promised that the woman who had struck the children would be fired and explained there was simply no clean water available for bathing the children. But just a few yards away, an open water faucet ran constantly, flooding the ground. The director of this institution resigned the day after we left. We pressed on, 400 miles north, where conditions were said to be even worse. Destination, Siret, an old monastery which houses 520 children. We entered the dungeon-like building. Even on sunny days, these youngsters are kept inside. At first glance, this place looked much like the overcrowded orphanages we had seen back in Bucharest. But as we went from room to room, down dark, dilapidated hallways, it became clear this place was different. We found children terrified of strangers. In some cribs, dazed toddlers were restrained in straitjacket fashion. In the next room, a little boy was doubled over, oblivious to his surroundings. Dr. Barbara Bascom traveled with us.
They certainly seem hungry for attention, don't they?
As a pediatrician, she could determine what problems had caused these children to be sent here. It was clear many had severe physical disabilities or were neurologically impaired. But Dr. Bascom also discovered a remarkable number of children with minor problems, crossed eyes or dumbo ears, conditions routinely treated elsewhere. And in every room, there were children who appeared normal.
I have no idea why these children are here.
These children, like thousands of others, have been misdiagnosed by this haphazard system. Others are abandoned gypsy children.
I think 80 to 90% of the children that I have seen in institutions were normal or had normal potential at the time of birth.
They came as normal children, and as a result of staying in this institution, they are no longer normal. They are now indistinguishable from the rest of children with severe neurological problems.
Looks like we're going to the basement, huh? The basement?
The most hopeless cases we discovered are sent for their final weeks to the basement, an anonymous death row. The children in this room are virtually ignored by a staff which has little medical training. When we asked what was wrong with this little boy, the aide simply shrugged. This child's leg is now crooked, the result of a fracture that was never set. Dying children, each case more senseless than the last.
This one especially seems to disturb you.
I think this is an outrage. This child has been deemed unsalvageable because of anemia.
Isn't anemia something that can be fairly easily and successfully treated?
Of course. Most forms of anemia are simple and very easy to completely reverse with proper treatment.
Dr. Bascom was astonished at the lack of basic resources available in Romania.
They don't have the hospitals, the labs, the x-ray machines, or any of the support services that are needed to make a diagnosis. You can't treat children without a diagnosis.
The only escape for this child now is death. They're buried here in anonymous graves in a field segregated from the main cemetery. This is the state's final solution. In one institution, 40% of the children died last year of infectious diseases and neglect. Remarkably, there's been no public outcry to pressure the new government to deal with this crisis.
These children are like prisoners of war, forgotten now that the war is over.
Dan Cristescu is Inspector General of Special Education in Romania.
Unfortunately, the general public's attitude towards handicapped persons still hasn't changed very much.
Look at this man. He's the typical Romanian leader. Dishonest, hypocrite, manipulative and crooked. He is the former criminal Romanian commie, or Satan in person. He holds a job he doesn't deserve, nor is he educated or suited for. He and his former commie colleagues have not only destroyed this nation, but they have also conned and manipulated the international helping organizations by stealing the goods they brought into Romania as help. He and his evil cockroach colleagues are now the richest people in Romania. Their wealth was obtained by killing and harming millions and millions of sick, poor, old, and innocent Romanians. Look at his eyes. The eyes of evil. That's how the evil Romanians look like.
As we traveled on, we discovered firsthand how public indifference impacts on these children. Day 3. We arrived at Gimish, a farming town tucked away deep in a scenic valley. It's a typical Romanian community where families are raising healthy, normal children. Every day on the main road, they pass by the yellow stone house with its padlocked front gate. But no one ever goes inside or asks if they can help.
The people of those villages are neither humane, nor are they true Romanians. true Romanians have done something for their country and for the world. True Romanians have risked their lives to escape the terrors of communism, and then they went back to Romania and helped. The people of those villages, like most of the other Romanians, are either cowards, ignorant, or some evildoers themselves.
Such isolation is devastating to the children living inside these state-run asylums.
He uses his peripheral vision, I think, a little bit.
Dr. Bascom found a child going blind from easily correctable cataracts, but no one had bothered to remove them.
What's your name? Come to camera.
Another child had been labeled retarded because of a mild speech impediment. But Jan discovered he's bilingual. He says he wants to go to school. There are no teachers here. Within minutes, Jan discovered a room full of relief supplies, toys, and clothing, locked away unused in a storage room. No one had bothered to give them to the children.
Those toys, received as international help, were to be later taken by the leaders of these institutions and then sold to store owners as if they were their own.
The staff is defensive when questioned about such inattention.
We saw a child with cataracts. Why is it that child had simple surgery to keep it from going blind?
He came like this to us and he just wasn't sent anywhere. He was born like this.
As for the toys, the nurse told us they were not distributed because the children would only destroy them.
We saw a child in the other room with Down syndrome. Normally they're very friendly and outgoing, but this child was frightened and shied away from us. He had a bruise over his eye. Is that child being abused here?
No. They're afraid of foreigners, of strangers.
Perhaps, but this is how the child reacted when we asked his nurse to approach him.
I think when you come to this country and you see these children, it changes you forever. But it also fills you with a determination to try to return with the kind of assistance that will prevent that from happening from other children who are destined for exactly the same kind of unit in an institution for the unsalvageable.
David, that was also your father's determination to stay there year after year and to do everything he could to help.
At an orphanage in the city of Brela, a little girl was heading for just such a fate when she was spotted by Sonia Patterson.
The first thing that caught my attention was her nose. That was it, because she has the same nose as me. And the orphanage director said to me, oh, forget that little girl. And she told me that Carmen was a child who they were going to send to a handicapped institution where they send the children who are the most severely handicapped.
The little girl was retarded, the director said. She didn't speak or respond to anyone. But Sonia and her husband decided they were willing to adopt a special needs child. While Sonia waited in Bucharest for the adoption to be finalized, she realized her new daughter was not brain damaged. She was a product of years of institutional neglect.
They don't know how to diagnose developmental problems, and they don't know how to treat developmentally disabled children.
Yet, the arrogant Romanian doctors speak about themselves as being the smartest, the brightest, and the best educated doctors in the world.
She's very precise with her fingers.
Dr. Bascom agreed to administer a developmental test to Carmen. She checked motor skills and learning potential.
Good girl. Okay, let's give the baby some food. Can you feed the baby?
She tested her ability to imitate and solve problems. There was no question. The little girl had been misdiagnosed.
Toy.
Toy.
Ah, good. Say baby. Spoon a baby.
Baby.
Bravo. I think of Carmen as being a cat with nine lives. She's changed 100% just in 1 week that I've had her.
Boop.
Bravo. I think that when she gets older and I tell her that the orphanage director considered her to be irrecuperable, I just hope that she's really happy that we took her away. Fizz me.
Well, that's a happy ending. But in part two of his report, Tom Jarrell enters an institution that shocked even veteran observers. Romanian authorities were clearly embarrassed.
Romanian authorities are never embarrassed. They are too evil to ever be embarrassed. They are evil. Pure evil. They are Satan's sons and daughters on earth.
Why are you putting us out? Why?
More of the shame of a nation, right after this.
We continue now with our report, The Shame of a Nation, Tom Jarrell's investigation of a really horrible tragedy befalling children in Romania. And again, this is not an update of previous stories about orphaned and AIDS babies in Romania.
No, these are new revelations of children labeled as handicapped or just undesirable who are dumped in concentration-type asylums all across Romania. Tom Jarrell is opening the doors and our eyes to these conditions. Now, just to get our bearings, Tom's travels in Romania began in the capital, Bucharest. He then flew to Romania's northern border and then back to points east and west, a total of more than 1,500 miles.
The last leg of our six-day journey was a gamble. Security at the next institution was said to be so tight that no one had been inside.
We cross mountains, we're going to Transylvania, we're going to fly here. It's right on the Russian border.
Right. What have you heard about this place?
It's a damn awful place.
The institution at Seghetu Mamartie was off the main road, behind a barbed wire fence, secured with a locked gate, and watched by a guard. Jan tricked the guard into unlocking the gate, and we all stormed in unannounced. Even after all we had seen, we were unprepared for what we found in an upstairs room. Here, young girls, their heads shaven, were kept in a giant cage like animals. Wild-eyed, screaming, half-naked, splashing in urine and excrement on the filthy floor. As the staff tried to quickly put clothing on them, we were ordered out.
Why are you putting us out? Why?
Downstairs, we confronted the director in his office.
He's saying, no cameras. He would rather not get the help than get the public exposure.
The bad publicity is because of the conditions. Why are hundreds of children naked, living in filthy conditions? They are living in conditions that they'll die unless you change it.
This is another bureaucrat who wants to stop the world from seeing the truth, the evil truth about them, about their inhumane practices, and about their evil hearts. Look, he is a doctor.
As we persisted, Barbara made a discovery. Right in the corner of the director's office, she found powerful tranquilizers.
You used tranquilizers with the children? Obviously you did.
Yes.
Look now, how the people of the civilized world unveiled just a small part of the Romanian criminal medical system. Yet, there is so much more the civilized world has not yet seen. In fact, there are so many criminal things happening there that the civilized world could not even imagine of possibly happening in this world. That system is full of criminals who bought their degrees from their corrupted professors who don't really care about learning medicine, but rather for how to get the prestige and the material possessions that comes with that profession. They act as gods, claiming they know everything, yet they are some pitiful parasitic criminal creatures who don't know anything about medicine. All they ever learned was on how to manipulate, intimidate, and threaten their old, sick, poor, and innocent patients so that they can take possessions of all their victims' goods.
And that's routine? To keep them quiet, to keep them under control?
Yes.
They say they use them as part of the routine treatment.
Routine treatment of what?
So you wouldn't normally prescribe
it? This is appropriate for adult psychiatric patients who are agitated and are uncontrollable physically. This is totally inappropriate medication for children. This is chemical restraints. This is as much as putting a rope on a child and tying him into a crib.
It didn't take long before Barbara found children, sedated and bound, just upstairs.
Is this proper treatment in this day and time for this child?
Absolutely not. He'll simply give up.
He'll be lost.
That's right. Physically, he could live a long time, but psychologically, this child will be completely lost.
Despite Dr. Bascom's protests, the staff retied this little boy as soon as we left the room. Across the hall, a death wail alerted us to a four-year-old child clinging to life. This pathetic little boy is named Ferente. He's not dying of an incurable illness like AIDS.
This child has cerebral palsy, but this is not what's killing this child. This child is dying of malnutrition.
This is an image from death camps. This is an image from Ethiopia starvation.
But those children, there was always a mother. These children are dying deaths without any comfort, without anyone even holding their little hands.
Doctor, this child appears to be dying of starvation, and he has severe infection. Why isn't he in a hospital?
He says, because these are nobody's children, no one wants to take them into the hospital.
As if to compound this tragedy, the pediatric hospital, which refused to admit this child, is located less than 100 feet away. 12 noon, we were allowed back inside the cage at the institution. It was mealtime. The food budget here is set by the government, 38 cents per day per child.
This exemplifies the cruelty and the evil in the hearts, minds, and souls of the Romanian politicians. Those poor children were supplied with 38 cents per day, yet, at this very time, the poisonous Romanian politicians, who were also the former Romanian criminal commies, were getting, legally and illegally, thousands and thousands of dollars per day. That shows they were heartless, inhumane, and evil beasts. Those cockroaches and scam bags shamelessly stole everything from everybody, including the money of those starving children. That's how, as they became more and more evil, they also became richer and richer.
We watched as a watery soup of broth and bread heels was shoveled into hungry mouths. Many of the children had never been taught to feed themselves. While the staff hurriedly fed half the children, just a few feet away, others were put on plastic potties in a bizarre daily routine that combines toilet time with meal time. For Jan, it was the breaking point.
These are human beings. These are human beings.
David, this is how a true Romanian looks like. All true Romanians have risked their lives and left the country to escape the terrors of communism. After the revolution, they returned to their homeland and did everything they could to help.
You're a Romanian. To see this in your home country, is that especially painful?
This would move me anywhere, Tom. Anywhere in the world, this is not acceptable. But it's happening here in Romania today. How can an institution and a society come so low that they forget basic respect for human life? And I know we can make a change. I know we can improve the situation for these children.
That is how a true Romanian living in the civilized world thinks. And that is The major difference between the way of thinking of Romanians living in Romania and Romanians living throughout the civilized world.
9 months after the revolution, the callous disregard for human life in this insane system seems unchanged. The Ministry of Labor ran these institutions during Ceausescu's regime. We asked the newly appointed minister why these death camps still operate.
It's difficult to say that this type of situation can totally change overnight. But I think in the last months have been many improvements in the conditions of life of these children.
Let me show you something that may shock you. These are some conditions we found in institutions just in the past few days. This child is literally starving to death. I mean, at every institution we went to, they had a small death row of children waiting to die.
Yes.
We can't talk in the past. The children are still in these institutions. Is anything being done about this?
This point, I think, has to be very clear. Nobody in Romania wants to these things to happen again. We need doctors, we need psychologists, we need sociologists, but our problem is that we have to train these people, and this will be the turning point.
But post-revolution Romania is overwhelmed by the aftermath of 25 years of totalitarian rule. A solution to this problem is years away. Until then, the children who live in these godforsaken places must depend on the help of outsiders. Jan Berende has now inspected 26 of the institutions for the unsalvageable to determine where the need is most urgent.
Yourself can be very useful for this effort.
Back in Boston, he has set up the Free Romania Foundation to put together a team of U.S. doctors, therapists, and teachers to return with him to Romania.
This system is here to stay unless there's intervention.
Dr. Bascom is working full-time with the World Vision Organization, fighting an uphill battle to convince Romanian doctors that some of these children could be saved with simple surgery or physical therapy.
Oh, here you are. Here you are.
For now, Barbara is forced to rescue these kids, one child at a time. She's currently hiding a little boy with club feet away from authorities while she searches for an adoptive home.
I was greeted with disbelief that there would be homes that would welcome a child with a handicap.
What this American doctor woman said about Romanians in the 1990s is also true about Romanians of the 2015s. The big majority of Romanians would never adopt a child with disabilities, simply because that is the way their minds are wired. That way of thinking clearly shows a lack of human kindness, compassion, and love, placing Romanians closer to the level of primitive human beasts than to the level of evolved human beings.
This child has won a special place in her heart. 25 years ago, Barbara adopted a son in the United States, born with the identical condition.
If this child has to leave this orphanage, he will go to an orphanage for the handicapped or for the non-recoverable.
So the non-recoverable policy still continues. It still is perpetuated even today.
That's the system's policy. If in 5 years the system is completely corrected, it will be too late for this child. He would be permanently disabled. He must have this corrected very soon.
As time runs out for four-year-old Vasily, Barbara has intensified her efforts to find parents for this little boy.
Olé!
But for now, most of these children are destined to remain exactly where they are, and they seem resigned to that fact. This little girl is blind and has been institutionalized most of her life. When we last saw her, she was singing the Romanian anthem of liberation. It goes, "Ole, ole, Ceausescu is no more." But she had changed the words. "Ole, ole, Ceausescu is with us still."
Ole, ole,
Tom, we've had many different features on this program that have moved us, but I'm sure the audience feels just as disturbed as we are. What can people who are watching do?
Barbara, medical technology and doctors, of course, are badly needed, but for the average viewer, probably donations to some of the many reputable, well-organized, and highly motivated international relief agencies working in Romania on this problem would be a good start.
It's moving and infuriating, but I can't accept the idea that the Romanian people are themselves either cruel or thoughtless. It surely must be the brutalization of being under the regime of a dictator who was at least as bad as Stalin was in Russia.
Hugh, I think that mindset of 25 years is still continuing, which is why the people of Romania don't see this as a problem. It's been a way of life.
What this man said in 1990 is very important, because that is the main problem in today's Romanian society. The people of Romania have been abused, manipulated, brainwashed and desensitized, and slowly transformed into animals, into wild savages, beasts. They are now insensitive to inhumane, unjust, poisonous, cruel, evil, and undignified practices.
From ABC News, around the world and into your home, the stories that touch your life, with Hugh Downs and Barbara Walters. This is 2020. The dramatic climax to 2020's epic series, The Orphans of Romania. Their story moved America and inspired a personal crusade.
For God's sake, let me help these kids.
A determined American fights for the forgotten children.
They're like kept like little reptiles in an aquarium.
Thousands still trapped in hopeless squalor, frequently abused.
Why is he tied? Huh? Why is he tied?
He is their hope for a new life. He rescued some of their friends. Now, they beg for themselves.
Tommy, I'll do to America.
How do you say I'll try?
Then the road to a new world, new sensations, and a reunion with old friends. Tom Gerald's final journey to Romania. To the children who know in their hearts there's a better world. From their mouths come words of hope. Take me to America.
At 36, the California filmmaker was living the American dream with his wife Suzanne and their three healthy children. His world revolved around luxury cars, the country club, and a home in an affluent neighborhood.
I was a poor kid from South Jersey that made it, and I was going to show everybody in the world that I made it. And then all of a sudden, I see some kids on television, and my life totally changes.
The television screen intruded into Upton's comfortable life in October 1990 as he watched 2020's report, Shame of a Nation, on the so-called unsalvageable children of Romania. As image after image flashed by, Upton spotted the face of one youngster who seemed to personify everything that was wrong. 12-year-old Elena Rostas, with one leg grotesquely twisted over her head.
I saw Elena, and I saw the way that she scooted around on her bottom, and I just had an overwhelming feeling to try to do something to help her, to get her out. I started pacing the floor. My wife said to me, "You're going over there, aren't you?" And I said, "I have to."
How soon after were you in Romania?
4 days after the broadcast.
He made his way to a remote corner of northwest Romania, to the town of Sighetu Mamartier. This is the institution that propelled John Upton into action, a cold concrete prison-like building where 216 children live. The kids here have been declared unsalvageable by the Romanian government because of physical or mental disabilities. The sign over the door is blunt: Hospital for Irrecuperable Children. Upton spent almost 6 weeks here in Romania back in 1990, getting to know the children at Sighetu.
The first day was overwhelming. The first day, the thing that overpowered me was the stench. then the misery, and then the need. It's something I can't describe.
This is number five.
He videotaped the children, hoping families back in San Diego might consider adopting them. But his main goal was to find Elena's parents, to obtain permission to bring her to the U.S. for medical treatment. Day after day, Upton was sent on wild goose chases by the former head of the institution.
The old director was giving me wrong addresses. He didn't want any of these kids out. He was probably thinking it was great, because I'm in this little car driving in these little gypsy villages. It was like a little bit of a nightmare. Like a big nightmare, as a matter of fact. Finally, after 6 weeks, my wife said, John, you have to come home. You know, how long are you going to stay there?
Ole, ole, ole.
Unwilling to come home empty-handed, Upton turned his attention to Anna Ostis. Blind since birth, she had spent her entire life at Sagetu. Within a week, Upton arrived in San Diego with 15-year-old Anna. What started out as a rescue back in 1990 would soon turn into a crusade. Upton began showing the videotape he shot at Sagetu Mamartier to couples in San Diego, a sad lineup of hopeful faces. One by one, families willing to provide foster homes selected children off the tape.
I'm not an adoption agency. I'm not a placement agency. I'm not a social worker. I'm not an expert. All I know is that people call me all the time and say, John, if you can get me a 10-year-old child that's handicapped, I'll take them in my home.
11-year-old Isidore is one of only five children who made it to the U.S. as a result of Upton's videotape crusade.
Angelica?
The young boy quickly began his own campaign to get Upton to return to Romania to rescue the friends he had left behind.
Isidore doesn't take no for an answer. Every time he'd see me, well, what about Janina? And what about Christina? Why can't you help them?
Simona and Ildi.
What did Al Pacino say in Godfather 3? Just when you thought you were out, they pull you back in. These kids pull me back in. I can't get out because you saw the kids in there.
6 a.m. Under the cover of darkness, our arrival at the gate of Sagetu had been precisely planned. Security was lax at this hour. We wanted to see how the children lived when outsiders weren't expected.
This morning they should be just waking up.
Yeah.
In the first room we visited, we found children sleeping two to a bed on urine-soaked sheets.
Tom, I could empty this room. We have foster homes. All these kids need medical treatment.
In room after room, we found children clearly in need of medical care, their bodies emaciated, some restrained in straitjackets.
This place is not suitable for animals, let alone for children.
In the corner upstairs, we found a little boy tied to a frigid pipe.
What's this? Why is he tied? Huh? Why is he tied? Look at his arm. His hands are like ice.
Despite the aid that has poured into this place from Western Charities since our last report, not much has changed here.
In our first report, nothing symbolized the hopeless plight of these children more than the prison-like caged room, where they were fed, bathed, and detained for most of the day. This September, in an effort to change the image of this place, they replaced the steel bars with clear glass windows. The irony of this improvement, you can see what's going on in this room even better now.
They're like kept like little reptiles in an aquarium.
Instead of coming to America, they come here. This is their life, this is it. There's no heat, it's cold. Hands are cold, but there's no heat.
The children's tattered clothing does not keep out the chill. This little boy's frail body was no match for the cold. We spotted Elena, the little girl who triggered Upton's rescue mission to Romania 2 years ago. She's now 15 years old. Her condition has deteriorated dramatically since Upton last saw her.
This place is taking a toll.
She just smashed her head into the wall.
She smashed her head. She's afraid. She's flinching. It breaks my heart. Because 2 years ago, I was holding her. I was touching her. But she's petrified now. Her mother wanted money for me to take this kid out. I searched for his mother for 2 years. I'm losing this kid. I should have been able to take this kid out 2 years ago.
I would like to just to tell the parents, no, you've abandoned this child. You can't, you know, who are you to tell me I can't have this child?
But obstacles stand in the way. Not only must Upton find the parents in a country with outdated records, few phones, and a difficult language barrier, under Romanian law, the parents who abandon their children are the only ones who can sign the papers for them to leave for medical treatment. So far, Upton has found fewer than half the parents of the children he's trying to rescue on this trip.
This is where, like, my pack is. These are the kids that are the most advanced, the kids that know where they are, and these are all my friends. Hello! Hello, Alexandra!
He's like a friendly uncle. He calls them by name, and they all remember him, the man from America who is their best hope for a new life. They know he can reunite them with friends who have already gotten out.
This is Christina Babushi.
This old videotape shows Christina with her two best friends, Isidore and Ciprian. She was left behind when the two boys were adopted by American families. He doesn't want to leave her again. Upton had found foster homes for almost every child in this room. 9-year-old Anna, 7-year-old Christian, 12-year-old Ileana, 16-year-old Hildy, 9-year-old Kostika, 17-year-old Janina, and 12-year-old Maureen.
He's called Maureen?
Maureen Moldovan.
Maureen is proving to be Upton's biggest worry on this trip. He had been assured the boy's father, a gypsy, had at last been located. But the address was wrong. Upton hires a Romanian to search full time, knowing the odds are against him.
It's a series of impossibilities, and we just deal with one after another. It takes a lot of time, it takes a lot of money, it takes a lot of frustration, a lot of hitting that wall and then saying, okay, now what do we do?
Time is his enemy. Everything is taking longer than expected. He knows the Romanian authorities might try to stop him at any moment.
When we come back, the dramatic conclusion of John Upton's personal crusade. Will his determined efforts to rescue the children succeed? And in the end, who will make the journey to America and who will be left behind?
So the man that the orphans called Johnny has returned to Romania determined to rescue as many of the children as he can from that miserable existence. But the bureaucratic roadblocks, as you saw, are just overwhelming. And the government that still can't care for its own children makes it extremely difficult for someone else to help. And while John Upton struggles with the system, the children wait, their hearts and their faces full of hope.
Although this is John Upton's first trip back here in 2 years, word has spread throughout the institution that Johnny has come to take more children to America. Hopes are soaring. 12-year-old Maureen Moldovan pleads for what every kid in this place is dreaming of. Take me to America.
How do you say I'll try? Okay. Ocean check? Yeah.
It seems every child here knows a lucky few will be getting out of this place.
I'm Johnny, that's right.
You become a Pied Piper to these kids. Do you worry that you may have overpromised them?
All the time. That's the pressure, because it's easy to be anonymous and to send a check and to keep your distance, but I've crossed that line, and some kids are going to get left behind, and that's going to be tough, but it's not going to be because of me.
It's okay.
A final decision is upon him. What to do about Ileana? He has finally gotten the paperwork he needs, but she's still out of control. Upton fears the long trip will be impossible in her current state.
I hope that I'm doing the right thing by taking her out of here. Is it more cruel to take her out and to introduce her in a new environment, or is it more cruel to leave her here? I don't know. I'm really having difficulty with this now.
There you go. That's better.
Hours later, Upton finally manages to break through to Ileana.
I know that she responds to affection. I know she responds to kindness. I don't know what kind of life she's going to lead. I don't know if she's ever going to be, quote, normal, unquote. But I know that she shouldn't have to be scooting around on the floor. And I know that we can help her somehow. Ileana was the reason why I came.
It was time to go home.
John, you've worked a long time toward this day.
2 years.
Are you anxious?
Now's the moment.
All right.
Now's the moment.
You have your records and files and information?
I'm ready to go.
The rescue effort has dragged on too long. Upton decides this is the day he must leave or risk losing it all. First stop, the director's office. In order to take the children out, he must get her signature on all the documents. Although the papers are in order, there's no guarantee the director will sign them. In fact, she can't be found.
Why isn't she here, though?
I don't know.
She knew we were coming.
I don't know.
Upton suspects the director is deliberately staying away to foil his plans.
I'm going to take the kids, I'm going to put them in the car, and I'm going. Hello?
Upton decides it's time to cut and run. With no one in charge, he takes matters into his own hands and announces the news to the kids waiting to find out if they'll stay behind or go. It's the most difficult moment of all.
Today, I will take some of you, but some of you... Some of you must stay here. Now, I'm going to call some names, and I want, when I call your name, to stand up, okay? Janina?
Out of this crowded room, only five names will be called. Upton tries to conceal his disappointment. He had hoped for many more.
Anna Ramona? Christian? Iliana? Christina Babushi. Now, these are the children that I can take today.
Little Maureen, his heart filled with hope, suddenly realizes he's being left behind.
You saw the kids that I'm not going to bring home. It's not because I can't. It's because I'm not allowed to.
It's okay. He's asking if you're going to take him to America.
Not today, but I'm going to take him someday.
Obviously, they want to go so badly.
Yeah, I know, but...
You can't walk away from this.
I can't, and I won't. I just want to get the kids out. It's been 2 years, and those last minutes, it was just hell, and I was really sweating bullets at that point in time. I will be back, okay? Be good. Be good. Okay, bye-bye. Let's go.
This is Upton's reward for 2 years of hard work. He marches out with a ragged band of children, not knowing if he'll be permitted to come back here
bye-bye.
To get the kids he's had to leave behind.
Hold hands. Come on.
The kids head for freedom.
Bye-bye.
They place their total confidence in him, leaving behind the only home they've ever known for the uncertainties of a country they know only as a word, America.
Christy.
The nurses realize the children won't be coming back.
It's okay. I finally have this kid in my arms, and I'm ready to put her in the van and take her to America.
In all, he'll be taking 9 children, half the number he had planned. The staff crowded together outside, uncertain how to react to Upton's unorthodox exodus with the children.
Bye-bye.
As Upton and the kids pull away in the little red van, familiar voices cry out to him. Within 24 hours, the kids had gone from a medieval asylum to the Edwardian, a 4-star luxury hotel in London, which put them up for free. They arrived bewildered and exhausted and stepped into the lap of luxury. 7-year-old Christian was fascinated by the automatic doors. They led to a world unlike any he had ever seen.
Within the span of 24 hours, they went from being in a prison to being in a hot bubble bath.
The final leg of their journey began at London's Heathrow Airport. Upton had convinced Richard Branson, the head of Virgin Airlines, to fly the kids to the United States for free.
America, we're here!
They landed at the Los Angeles International Airport and boarded a bus for San Diego.
San
Diego.
Ego.
San Diego.
Santo Ego.
Hi, is it to me?
Yeah.
Hi, is it to me?
Isidore's here. Look, everybody's there.
Their first stop was a surprise reunion with the five children who had gotten out of Sagetu 2 years ago. Familiar faces and their strange new world. The kids from Romania had a surprise for their friend Isidore, the boy who had prodded and pushed John Upton into going back to rescue them. They had written a song for him.
Isidore, Isidore.
Elena is now in a San Diego hospital. A team of surgeons have volunteered their services to try to correct her twisted leg. The complicated operation will take place next year. Christina is also living in San Diego. The three musketeers from Sagetu have been reunited.
He comes with us.
The other six children were flown to Norfolk, Virginia, where foster families who hope to ultimately adopt these kids were waiting.
Christian, look. Daddy.
Daddy.
Papa.
As for Upton, last month he succeeded in getting 10 more kids out. But 12-year-old Marine remains at Sagetu.
I cannot get him out the way the system is now. But he doesn't understand the system. All he understands is that I'm taking his friends out. Why can't I take him out?
Oh.
Because I can't find his parents.
Right.
I have to get control of myself. It's the first time you stop.
Remember those hopeless faces we saw in the institution for the so-called unsalvageable children at Sagetu Montmartier. One of them was 10-year-old Anna. She and four other children were taken in by families from a church group in Virginia.
For us, it brings a sense of completeness. We're a family now.
Linda and Joe Sawanovich of Virginia had their dream of a family come true thanks to a couple of kids from Sagetu. 8-year-old Christian has become a choir boy, rambunctious and happy. Remember little Marine Moldovan? Oh, the hearts that went out to him when he was left behind. This Christmas, Marine has a home in California with Judy and Darren Ludlam, and he's fast becoming an American teenager.
What's the name?
I'm not telling. Surprise.
Surprise.
Remember the three musketeers we met at Sagetu Montmartier? Well, they now live in the same neighborhood in San Diego and are still the best of friends. 15-year-old Christina loves to sing. 12-year-old Ciprian can't stop riding his bicycle. And 13-year-old Isidore has become the All-American baseball player.
Best Christmas. And what have you done?
Merry Christmas, sweetheart.
Merry Christmas.
Okie dokie.
Well, let's go get wet. Yes, I know.
You won't just be gone. And so this is Christmas.
Merry Christmas, everyone, from Jessica.
Okay.
Isn't it great to see them?
Smiling with tears in our eyes.
Doing well.
You know what they call me here? No. Patricia. I'm glad it's funny. So I drop the A and make it Patric.
Patrica.
But apparently in Romania, my name is like a grandfather's name.
Privindu-l, ascultându-l, ți-e aproape imposibil să crezi că trecutul acestui băiat inteligent, frumos, cu privire tristă și aer melancolic, ascunde o poveste cutremurătoare și că drumul lui spre America a pornit de aici. Începutul anilor 90, la momentul respectiv, se numea Petrică Cășlaru și avea 9 ani, dintre care ultimii doi petrecuți într-un pat al Spitalului de Boli Neuropsihice din Siret, incapabil să se miște.
Este posibil să stai sus? Hai, eu ajut.
Era unul dintre acei copii închiși în orfelinatele groazei din România, o rușine dezvăluită lumii de jurnaliști și voluntari străini în primii ani de după Revoluție.
In more than 50 institutions hidden in remote areas of Romania, innocent children are locked away like condemned prisoners. Children with physical or mental defects are banished by a government which has branded them worthless.
Pe românește, irecuperabili. Erau fie micuți nedoriți, fie copii internați pe viață din cauza unor handicapuri mai mult sau mai puțin severe. Cu toții maltratați, înfometați, reduși la stadiul de sub-oameni și fără șansa de a deveni vreodată normali, cu toate că foarte mulți dintre ei nu aveau nicio afecțiune fizică sau psihică.
These children, like thousands of others, have been misdiagnosed by this haphazard system.
I think 80 to 90% of the children that I have seen in institutions were normal or had normal potential at the time of birth.
Și în acest iad imaginat de regimul comunist care a înghițit câteva sute de mii de copii în cele două decenii de existență, lagărul spital de la Siret era printre cele mai crunte. Petrică își amintește bine momentul în care a văzut pentru prima oară fortăreața în care avea să-și petreacă cei din tâi ani din viață. Îl adusese mama lui, care abandonase aici cu un an înainte un alt copil, pe Marcel.
The building looked like a prison. It was something in a Nazi film. They had this huge wall around it, so you can't see in, and the kids inside can't see out, unless you're in the building.
Era de fapt o fostă cazarmă, transformată în spital de boli psihice, iar la adăpostul acestei închisori impenetrabile se petreceau lucruri greu de imaginat pentru lumea de afară.
A lot of starvation, a lot of raping, a lot of beating. I can't describe it, it's just, it was hell on earth. I was younger than all of them. If you didn't obey, they beat you. If you didn't obey, you got to sleep with other kids. If you didn't obey, you didn't get to eat. The employees there, if you're their favorite, they'd bring you food. If you weren't, they would just beat you for no reason.
Vorbește despre el cel de atunci ca despre cineva pe care nu l-a cunoscut decât întreacăt și care i-a lăsat lui moștenire aceste povești. Întâmplări oribile care și-au pus amprenta pe cei mai slabi, transformându-i exact în ceea ce speraseră creatorii acestor lagăre. Niște umbre care dispăreau una câte una. Vieți curmate de un regim nemilos, ajutat de angajați cu instincte criminale.
They would just take a sheet, tear it off, and just tie their hands to the bedpost. And I remember going to the girls' part, and I just looked into the room. I just remember seeing this girl that had a rope tied around her neck until she died. She was strangled to death.
Și mai erau abuzurile sexuale. Petrica recunoaște că până și lui, un supraviețuitor, noaptea îi era cel mai teamă. Când lumina se stingea pe holuri, iar infirmierii plecau acasă, băieții mai mari ieșeau din subsolul în care dormeau la un loc cu muribunzii și profitau de forța lor fizică și de autoritatea de îngrijitori nocturni.
It was maybe two or three of them. That it was huge. So anytime they would pop their head in to see if everything was fine, they would close the door, and then after that it's whatever goes. I slept most nights with the blanket over my head. The weakest link got it more than the person that actually could speak and actually stand up for himself.
El a învățat că singura soluție să scape de abuzuri și să rămână în viață era să lovească, preventiv.
I beat kids. I beat them for no reason, just to show the other guys that I'm tough. One time, I punched him, punched Mirjo. Just because I wanted to.
Și acest antrenament i-a folosit. La vârsta de 7 ani a alunecat pe mizeria din baie și și-a rupt piciorul. L-au așezat într-un pat și nu l-au mai mișcat de acolo, așa că oasele i s-au sudat greșit. Devenise vulnerabil și atunci a început să bată și mai crunt. Aici ajunsese când l-a întâlnit pe americanul Ronald Federici, doctor în psihiatrie infantilă și unul dintre primii străini care au pus piciorul în lagărele de copii din România.
I've been in China, I've been in Africa, I've been in South America, I've seen some very terrible places and terrible damage to children. Romania was by far the worst I'd have ever seen. I called it the second Holocaust of children because the places that I went to were no different than looked like concentration camps. Every orphanage we found, a death rate. A lot of the children died from what we call institutionalization or trauma. They were neglected, abused, raped, terribly treated, so long and so much, some would kill themselves, some would hang themselves, but many of them just gave up. They stopped eating, they stopped talking, they sat in the corner and they rocked, they hit their head. They became like animals.
Sosise la Siret după Revoluție, chemat de voluntarii occidentali care descoperiseră grozăvia din așa zisele spitale de boli neuropsihice. Printre ei, Monica McDade, o profesoară care ajunsese în România accidental și puțin împotriva voinței ei, dar care a sfârșit prin a-și dedica 10 ani din viață acelor copii oropsiți.
Every time I think about giving up, which sometimes I do because I'm so frustrated, I just have to think of these kids. This is their life locked behind these bars. There's nothing for them. And if we didn't continue to work here, that frightens me.
Abia astăzi, după alți 10 ani, a găsit curajul să se întoarcă la Siret, să vadă ce s-a ales din moștenirea lăsată de ea. Clădirea fostului spital a devenit între timp o ruină, de parcă o forță divină a vrut să spele rușinea petrecută aici. Însă chiar și așa, amintirile încep să o bântuie.
I remember standing here and all I could see, all these were barred, all bars, and all you could see were hands flailing out of them. Help! I will always remember one young lad just getting on his knees and dragging me here from my knees, saying, Monica, please don't let me die in this place. And I'm thinking, oh God, you know, tears, you know. And I says, I will do what I can.
Și a făcut pentru fiecare dintre ei. Însă cel mai mult s-a zbătut pentru cei care intraseră aici perfect sănătoși, dar care începuseră să dea semne de retard sau să aibă simptome de afecțiuni psihice din cauza contactului permanent cu copiii bolnavi și care, dacă ar fi rămas acolo, ar fi devenit exact ceea ce pretinsese regimul că sunt, irecuperabili. Printre ei, Petrică Cășlaru.
There's no hope for this child. This is his life. Because there's nobody going to take him.
Și totuși, cineva l-a luat. Doctorul Federici, chemat în ajutor de Monica McDade, a fost cucerit pe loc de acel băiețel din care, în pofida sechelelor fizice și psihice, răzbătea forța.
So your leg is locked.
Da, dar o zis, mămică, mi-a dus un soare, tine.
What are your dreams? What would you like to be one day?
Priest.
Priest?
Ronald Federici a decis chiar atunci să-i adopte pe Petrică și pe fratele lui Marcel.
They were severely neglected and malnourished and they were very, very bad shape. When I found them, they might have weighed 14 kilos at most. They looked like ghosts. They were very, very sick.
Ceva mai târziu au descoperit că într-un alt spital mai există un frate de-al lor, Daniel, iar doctorul Federici i-a luat pe toți trei și i-a dus în America, unde a început să-i pună încet, încet pe picioare, tratându-i, crescându-i, educându-i ca pe niște mici sălbăticiuni.
Food, clothing, toilet, bath, hygiene, it was, they had no idea what was normal. They had many surgeries, medical care, neurological care, orthopedic surgery. We estimated when they came to the States that if they would have stayed in Surat, they would have been dead within 2 to 3 months.
Dar au supraviețuit și bolilor cu care veniseră de la Siret și traumelor căpătate acolo. Însă după anii petrecuți în lagărul de copii, cel mai greu le-a fost să înțeleagă că sunt liberi.
I was in the hospital for a year and I remember sitting there and the nurse is going, you know, you can wheel yourself around. I said, what? I can leave this room? And I was like, wow.
Apoi au luat școala de la zero alături de copii mult mai mici ca ei.
All I remember is they wanted to come home early from school. I don't know why.
Apparently you were crying.
I don't know.
Apparently
that.
He was overwhelmed with too much going around. And that's what I was told.
Marcel a făcut o școală specială pentru copiii cu deficiențe mentale. A rămas cu traume mai mari decât Petrică și cu probleme de vorbire, așa că visul lui cel mare de a deveni actor nu pare să iasă. Dar și-a găsit o ocupație la care are un real talent. Are grijă de copiii cu probleme comportamentale. În timp, Petrică a uitat și accentul moldovenesc și limba română. În schimb, s-a operat la picior și poate merge, chiar dacă șchiopătând ușor. Mușchii piciorului, atrofiați la siret, nu și-au mai revenit. A abandonat planurile de a deveni preot și se pregătește pentru admiterea la medicină. Locuiesc ei trei și omul care i-a salvat într-o fermă mare de lângă Washington și sunt fericiți cum nu s-au gândit probabil niciodată în acei ani teribili că vor fi vreodată.
What you have in common with him now?
Strength. Strength.
You feel pity for him?
No. I don't feel pity for anybody. It happened, you went through it, you get over it. It sucks. That's how life is. Life is full of speed bumps, and this was my speed bump. I got over it when they told me I was gonna die in a couple of months, you know, when I got here. Boy, did I prove them wrong.
Despre cealaltă viață a lor vorbesc rar, au preferat să o uite, s-au protejat. Dar acum, rememorând toate acele întâmplări, Petrică nu poate să nu se întrebe ce s-a întâmplat cu ceilalți 600 de copii de la Siret, dacă au avut norocul lui sau dacă au rămas așa cum i-a vrut sistemul, irecuperabil. Și mai ales ar vrea să știe ce s-a întâmplat cu unul dintre ei.
There's just one guy that was in charge of carrying me around. And every time I was to go take a shower, be like 20 kids using two shower heads. And now is the guy on the floor waiting for some water to just hit me. The guy right here. Mm-hmm. He carried me for 2 years.
What's his name?
Mihai. He's a kid I beat every day.
Mihai Zapcevski, ocrotitorul lui Petrică, e tot la Siret și de această dată cu adevărat irecuperabil. Boala din el, anii de spital, haosul de după, dezinteresul celorlalți i-au oprit dezvoltarea, i-au agravat afecțiunea și i-au dat altele noi.
Câți ani ai?
Nu știu, zi.
Nu știe de ce am venit și nici că l-am cunoscut pe Petrică, dar dintr-o dată își amintește singur și începe să ne povestească despre cel mai bun prieten al lui. E primul lucru care îi vine în minte mereu.
Ăla soțul mează, de țelan în Petrică, să mă bătă pe mine. Da.
De ce te-a bătut?
N-a făcut nimic eu.
Cine e în poza?
Petrică. Petrică e cu picioarele bolnav. Era Petre, dar m-a bătat pe mine.
Mai ții minte că avea și un frate? Mai ții minte?
Da, mase, cunosc, mase.
Și, pentru prima oară, după aproape două decenii, își vede prietenul. Deși e schimbat, îl recunoaște imediat.
Da. O să fie frumos.
E frumos?
Da. Cam asta. Fan.
Seamănă?
Seamănă. Hai, Petrică, să vine și la mine. Să vedeți pe mine.
Viața lui e mai bună acum, dar el tot se poartă de parcă fiecare zi ar fi o luptă. La masă nu se satură nici după 2-3 porții, atât de dură e amintirea lipsurilor din copilărie. Și între timp, din băiatul blând care îl ducea în brațe pe Petrică, s-a transformat într-un pacient foarte violent. Așa că azi e ultima lui zi în acest centru. Va fi mutat într-un loc în care va sta mai mult singur, ca să nu mai poată agresa pe nimeni. După plecarea voluntarilor, statul român a rămas iar fără soluții pentru oameni ca el. Le-a dat mâncare și medicamente, dar n-a știut cum să integreze în comunități. Și astfel, deși acum 3 decenii nu avea decât un ușor retard, astăzi Mihai e pierdut.
Din experiența pe care o avem, din lucru cu acești copii, este realist să credem că sunt tineri care ar fi avut o cu totul altă dezvoltare dacă n-ar fi avut ghinionul să ajungă în acest spital. Skills-urile lui de viață independentă sunt undeva la nivel de 4 ani, poate. Deci se poate hrăni singur, poate să bea apă singur și știe să meargă la toaletă. Cam aici ne oprim.
Zilele lui Mihai se scurg exact ca acum 20 de ani. Privind în gol, vizita noastră i-a schimbat puțin starea. A devenit mai prezent, mai atent, aproape nostalgic.
L-am întrebat dacă își amintește de cineva. Și mi-a zis da, de Mihai doar. Uite, ia poza și mi-arată unde ești tu.
În poza.
Vezi? Tu.
La plecare ne roagă să-i lăsăm fotografia cu Petrică, să-i o arate în ziua în care va veni să-l vadă.
Aghizi poza mea, da?
Apoi începe să plângă mut, probabil speriat că rămâne din nou singur, pentru că nici unul dintre cei de care se legase nu mai e lângă el. În 1998, 40 dintre cei 600 de copii de la Siret au fost duși de Monica McDade în căsuțe special construite în oraș și și-au revenit în mare parte. Azi trăiesc și se gospodăresc singuri. S-au angajat și unii chiar au planuri să-și facă o familie. Alții n-au avut norocul lor. Voluntarii irlandezi au plecat, convinși că investiția lor de 1 milion de euro în fosta cazarmă le va aduce copiilor o viață mai bună. Dar, în urma lor, a venit statul român și a stricat totul.
Închiderea Spitalului de Copii Neuropsihici Siret a fost condiție pentru aderarea României la Uniunea Europeană. Ce a făcut atunci statul? A rezolvat problema în stil pur românesc. Aici a pus lacătul și a lăsat așa până s-a ales praful de tot. Iar pe tineri i-a mutat într-o clădire unde condițiile erau mult, mult mai rele.
Adică aici, într-un imobil construit în 1896, care stă să cadă peste cei 120 de copii năpăstuiți, deveniți între timp adulți. N-a existat nici măcar decența de a-i muta 2 metri mai la dreapta în clădirea nouă, construită din donații chiar pentru ei. N-a vrut Ministerul Sănătății să dea 20.000 de euro pentru centrala termică. Așa că i-a abandonat într-un fel de închisoare în care îi găsești în fiecare zi adunați la gratiile curții interioare, cum au învățat de mici. E aici și Ciprian, băiețelul cu ochi albaștri, a cărui imagine a făcut acum 20 de ani în conjurul lumii. E și Costel, cel care i-a înspăimântat pe străini cu mișcările lui incontrolabile. Și e și Florin, copilul care a sărit înspăimântat pe masă când camerele jurnaliștilor occidentali s-au apropiat de el. Și uimitor, deși sistemul îl crede irecuperabil, el își amintește acel moment.
Mai țin minte când erai tu pe măsuță într-un și a venit cu camera la tine și te-ai speriat? Da. Da. Mai țin minte?
Da.
Unde erai atunci?
Unde?
În afară de starea lor, care s-a agravat între timp, multe nu s-au schimbat în jur. Locuiesc tot ca atunci în camere cu geamuri mici, pereți crăpați și tencuiala căzută. Și sunt tot câte 15-20 cu o singură infirmieră pe salon. Personalul face eforturi să-i îngrijească, dar e greu când trebuie să-i care în brațe pe scările întunecoase, să-i panseze în timp ce ei devin agresivi și să le facă mâncare din cei 9 lei pe zi cât le dă Ministerul Sănătății. Iar directorul spitalului, care îi cunoaște de pe vremea în care lucra la Siret ca voluntar, se uită cu inima frântă cum se degradează acești oameni.
Poate funcționeze un spital într-o astfel de clădire? Nu cred. Ei trăiesc o viață de coșmar în continuare. Faptul că acești copii există nu este nici vina lor și nici măcar nu este vina familiilor. Este vina unui sistem inuman, prost gândit. Trebuie să ne asumăm greșeala și să facem ceva.
Doar că sistemul nu numai că nu și-o asumă, dar mai și recidivează. Deși pare greu de crezut, aceste imagini au fost filmate în urmă cu o săptămână într-un centru de recuperare și reabilitare neuropsihică. Iar pacienții pe care îi vedeți sunt în mare parte foști copii abandonați în orfelinatele rușinii. Uluitor e faptul că acest loc se găsește în vecinătatea unui faimos club de noapte în sectorul 2 din București.
In many respects, they're still seen as irrecuperable. Just that total loss of human kindness or affection or emotion. And they're living lifeless people. And this is 22 years on. So why? Why is it still here?
se întâmplă din neglijență criminală a sistemului și a oamenilor din el. La începutul anilor 90, orfanii irecuperabili din căminul de la Plătărești, județul Călăraș, au fost mutați la București. În 2010, printre ei s-a făcut o selecție și cei care depindeau mai mult de ajutorul îngrijitorilor au fost aduși aici, la centrul Gheorghe Șerban, fostul orfelinat Luminița. O vreme de ei s-au ocupat voluntarii români și străini. Apoi însă porțile centrului s-au închis brusc și nicio organizație n-a mai reușit să intre. Un fost angajat al Direcției Generale de Asistență Socială și Protecția Copilului a reușit să filmeze în 2012 tratamentul degradant la care erau supuși pacienții și ne spune ce se întâmpla înăuntru.
Tinerii au tot timpul ținuți în întuneric, zi și noapte, cu șalzele trase. Uneori erau loviți, alteori se țipa la ei ca să tacă. Erau sedați. Mâinile și picioarele erau legate pentru a împiedica să coboare din pat sau să se lovească. Erau pur și simplu legați cu bucăți rupte din cerceafuri vechi. Infirmierele îi hrăneau cât de repede puteau, chiar în timp ce stăteau culcați pe spate. Le deschideau gura larg și le băgau repede mâncare, ei se înnecau și o scuipau.
Un ONG pentru apărarea drepturilor omului a încercat să intre acolo în primăvara anului trecut. S-a lovit însă de opoziția suspectă a șefului de centru.
Întâlnirea a decurs în termen neconform cu atitudinea unui angajat într-o instituție publică. Fum de țigară mult, mizerie și multă aroganță. Adică, cine sunteți voi să veniți să îmi spuneți că vreți să vedeți instituția?
Georgiana Pascu a trimis plângeri și sesizări către toate instituțiile responsabile, atrăgând atenția că, dacă faptele se confirmă, centrul se face vinovat de încălcarea mai multor legi naționale și internaționale privind tortura și drepturile omului.
Am primit un răspuns din partea DGASPC Sector 2, evident că nu este nicio problemă. De la Ministrul Muncii nu am primit niciodată niciun răspuns. În schimb, am primit un răspuns de la directorul Agenției Naționale pentru Prestații și Inspecție Socială. Veți avea acces atunci când nu veți mai colabora cu organizațiile internaționale și nu veți mai vorbi cu presa.
Așa că a mers în instanță, iar procesul e în curs. Am cerut și noi să intrăm în fostul orfelinat ca să vedem care sunt de fapt condițiile în care sunt ținuți cei 54 de bolnavi. Și surprinzător, nouă ne-a fost permis. În clădire, totul strălucește. Holurile sunt pline de angajați, iar paturile din dormitoare au cearșafuri proaspăt schimbate. Până și jucăriile noi sunt aranjate la milimetru. Dar o scurtă privire aruncată pacienților îți arată că acolo ceva nu e în regulă. Trupurile emaciate îți dau impresia că stai lângă niște muribunzi. Prin pielea fețelor ies oasele maxilarului, privirile sunt goale. Pacienții nu sunt legați de mâini, însă unii dintre ei stau într-o poziție care pare să arate că au fost imobilizați multă vreme. În acest loc care te cutremură, păpușile par o bătaie de joc. În pat e un trup descărnat, în mod evident chinuit de dureri. Și figura lui e vag familiară. E Dumitru Nistor, un pacient pe care l-am văzut într-o fotografie făcută în urmă cu 5 ani. Era pe o plajă în Mamaia, unde fusese dus împreună cu alți 40 de pacienți de un voluntar scoțian. Fotografia de atunci îl arată zâmbitor, solid și puternic.
Nistor is a young lad full of character. He loved classical music. His eyes just tell everything, like, yeah, what's next, and the holiday. He was just loving all the excitement of eating ice cream and going in the water and going in the gondolas.
În acea vacanță, Nistor învăța să meargă și să mănânce singur. Acum e aproape invizibil de slab ce e și de nerecunoscut. I-am arătat Lindei Bar imaginile pe care le-am filmat în centrul Gheorghe Șerban și femeia e șocată de ce vede.
He's lost quite a bit of weight and looks thin, to say the least. Sorry.
O involuție atât de severă, spun medicii, poate fi explicată uneori de afecțiunile psihice de care suferă pacienții de la Gheorghe Șerban. Dar dincolo de asta, specialiștii mai constată ceva. Neglijență, lipsă de interes, refuzul acordării de șanse, echivalentul malpraxisului.
El este un adult ce caută într-un pat de copil. Ar putea să-și întindă picioarele în patul ăsta. De ce nu are un pat care să respectă normele? Știi, un pat de adult are 190x120. Asta e o chestie barbară. Eu nu cred că oamenilor ăstora cineva le-a explicat vreodată care sunt soluțiile bune. Și ce caută măgărușul ăla într-un pat de anunt? Mai pus special pentru vizitator.
Doctorul vede apoi și imaginea unei paciente care stă într-o poziție nefirească.
O persoană într-o poziție fetală este o persoană care are o formă de suferință psihologică și parte din suferința aia psihologică este o carență de atașament. E tulburător, e un om singur, care nu e atins. Bătaia era o formă de atingere umană. Fetița asta nici măcar bătută n-a fost. A fost neglijat. Psihicul ei este aproape de 0%. Pentru mine asta devine deja o problemă.
Și apoi confirmă cele mai negre temeri ale voluntarilor.
Vezi, aici practic nu mai ai mușchi. Asta este o atrofie musculară avansată. Te uiți la structura asta cerată pergamentoasă a mâinii. Asta e un mântuit.
Iar când vede fotografiile și filmele făcute în urmă cu un an, doctorul are o concluzie fermă.
Asta e tortură modernă. Eu aș conjura pe oricine din Ministerul Sănătății să accepte timp de 30 de minute să fie legat exact în formatul ăsta, exact în poziția asta, și apoi să descrie experiența.
Revolta doctorului e explicabilă, la fel și iritarea directorului Izabela Hurjui, doar că motivele ei sunt altele. De unde am obținut noi aceste imagini?
Asta este un lucru pe care aceste poze, o să vă rog dacă puteți să mi le puneți și mie la dispoziție, să verific exact despre ce este vorba.
Look at this person. She is the typical Romanian bureaucrat. You could easily see her criminal mind, poisonous heart, reptilian brain, and evil arrogance, as she continuously puts the blame on others, threatening everything and everybody. Look at her. Look at her body language, and then, listen carefully to her words. She cannot say anything meaningful, yet, she has the audacity to threaten. By looking at her, you could easily see the Romanian evil. That's how a typical Romanian bureaucrat looks like, and that's the type of person Romanians are forced to face every day. Those cockroaches have abused, harassed, threatened, and caused sufferings to millions and millions of innocent Romanians. She and the others like her are the richest in the country, yet, at the same time, the most evil of all.
Deci în momentul ăsta nu pot să explic ce este acolo. Da? Deci trebuie să cercetez, să văd exact ce s-a întâmplat, iar cine este responsabil va și pleca.
Nici despre starea jalnică a pacienților nu are prea multe de spus.
Care sunt simptomele de malnutriție?
Bun, acum cu simptomele de malnutriție sunt mai multe. Poate să vă explice un nutriționist mai bine decât mine.
Cu siguranță, dar și dumneavoastră le cunoașteți. Care sunt câteva dintre
acestea? Cum am spus, adresați-vă unui nutriționist.
În urmă cu un an, sesizată despre problemele de la Gheorghe Șerban, Agenția de Inspecție Socială i-a cerut Izabelei Hurjui să ia o serie de măsuri. În noiembrie însă, la o inspecție ulterioară, s-a constatat nu numai că situația nu era încă rezolvată, dar centrul nici măcar nu avea autorizație de funcționare. La vederea imaginilor filmate de noi, directorul agenției ne-a promis că va face acolo un nou control săptămâna viitoare.
Și în felul cum va arăta centru acum și diferența comparativă, vom lua măsurile necesare și vom anunța instituțiile coordonatoare acestea.
Doar că e nevoie de mai mult de atât pentru acești pacienți care duc de 20-30 de ani un trai inuman. Ei nu mai au timp nici de birocrația românească, nici de prevederi noi, ci doar de un personal cu inimă și o mentalitate care să nu mai țină de vremurile negre ale secolului trecut.
Dacă citești cărțile de psihologie scrise de supraviețuitorii din lagăre, ai să observi următoarea constantă. Primul pas către tortură constă în două propoziții. Ei nu sunt ca noi și ei nu sunt oameni. Ei nu sunt ca noi, nu?
Orfanii lui Ceaușescu au ajuns victimele României de astăzi. După 23 de ani, ca mentalitate, suntem tot acolo. E mai curat în jur și păstrăm aparențele mai bine, dar în fapt, generația copiilor nedoriți de după 67 rămâne condamnată. Iar acești oameni, fără vină și fără noroc, dispar, unul câte unul, în gropi săpate în grabă în cimitirele săracilor și abia dincolo vor înceta să mai fie irecuperabili.
I'm Dr. Jane Aronson, and I'm an adoption medicine specialist. When you hear me talk about Romania, as the expression goes, you cut your teeth, right? This was how I learned about adoption. Sorry. I haven't talked about this in a long time. It was the most unreal experience that I've ever had in my life. It's so heinous. It's so vile that you can't even take it in. I felt nauseous and faint, almost like guilty for even being there. They were skeletal and emaciated. And I've never seen that anywhere except Romania.